This video will demonstrate some of the graphical options for visualizing and presenting results from an SRH 2D model. The visualization options that will be covered and the order that they will be reviewed are outlined in this slide. Vectors refers to arrows drawn to visualize vector datasets. The most common vector dataset, especially when working with a hydraulic model like SRH 2D, is velocity. So the options discussed in this video will focus on visualizing velocity datasets, but the same display options can be applied to any vector dataset. Contours are used to visualize scalar datasets such as depth or water surface elevation. Lighting can be enabled and manipulated to create shadows and highlights. Texture mapping is used to drape aerial photos or maps onto a surface. The functional surface is a 3D rendering of scalar datasets. Let's start by opening an existing SRH 2D project with solutions in SMS. The velocity dataset is a vector dataset, and arrows are used to visualize the magnitude and direction components of the vector. There are numerous settings for drawing vector arrows, and I'll review some of the more commonly used options. Each of these options are described in more detail on the SMS wiki pages. Links to these pages are listed at the end of this video. Display placement controls where the arrows are drawn. The default option is to draw arrows at each node. However, this can be unwieldy for meshes with too many nodes as the display becomes cluttered and unreadable. Displaying arrows on a grid will create arrows along specified distances apart in pixels in the X and Y direction. For example, an X spacing of 20 pixels will cause arrows to be drawn every 20 pixels in the X or horizontal direction, no matter the level of zoom. Displaying on a coverage places arrows at the location of feature objects in the specified coverage. For example, a coverage could contain arcs through certain sections of a channel. Arrows would then display at the locations of these arcs. When displaying vectors on a grid or using a coverage, the displayed vectors are interpolated from nearby nodes on the mesh. Origin and offset can be used to adjust placement of arrows if they conflict with or are covered by other things, such as contours. Data range can be used to control what range of values are used to display vectors. One application of this can be to avoid displaying vectors for very small velocities. The options on the right side of this dialog control the appearance of the individual arrows. Arrow sizes can be scaled based on the magnitude, so that areas with higher velocities will have larger arrows. The arrows follow flow path toggle will allow vector arrows to curve to follow the flow field. There are also options to manipulate the shape and relative size of arrowheads. Arrows can be drawn in a single color or have their color vary based on magnitude using a specified color palette. We will give an example of one possible configuration of these settings. We will also adjust the display controls of the 2D mesh module to remove clutter and isolate the display of vectors on the mesh by removing contours and element edges. We can see how the vectors are displayed on a grid, curved to follow a flow path, and are colored and sized based on their magnitude. Next is contour options. Contour display options can be set for all datasets in a module at once, or to differ individually to specified datasets. These are referred to as global display options and dataset-specific display options. Global display options are defined using the interface in the Display Options dialog, which is accessed from either the Display Options button in the toolbar or from the main menu display pulldown. These options apply to all scalar datasets within the given module, which are without individually specified contour options. Dataset-specific contour options can be defined by right-clicking on the dataset in the Project Explorer and selecting Dataset-specific contour options. Datasets that have been assigned specific contour options will use those instead of the options defined using the global display options. Dataset-specific contour options can be removed using the same right-click menu in the Project Explorer. Once removed, the contours will change back to those defined in the global display options. There are numerous options for controlling the display of contours, and additional information can be found on the SMS Wiki. Links to this are provided at the end of the video. Contours can be linear, where each line represents a constant value. Contours can also be color-filled, where regions of color represent a certain dataset value range. There are several options for populating the colors in the contour range. Intensity ramp is a luminance range of a single color. Use the hue ramp option to select a color range within the given color spectrum. The user-defined option is used to create custom palettes. There are also load and save options here to import or export a palette file. So, a palette you create can be saved for future projects, or the palette file be sent to or received from someone else for use. When creating a new user-defined palette, there are a few predefined palettes to start with. Individual colors can be added, removed, or moved around to create any custom color range. Sometimes, it can be useful to specify a dataset range for contours. For example, when working with a depth dataset, you could limit the contour range to a certain depth threshold and higher, or effectively wet. The contour interval can be determined using a couple of different methods. The specified interval option allows you to choose the desired interval, and SMS will determine the number of contours needed for the given range. The number option lets you specify how many contours you want, and SMS will automatically determine the interval for the given range. The specified values option lets you determine both the number of contours and the interval between them. The transparency level can be adjusted so that background objects such as images or maps remain visible when covered by contours. The precision option determines how many decimal places are used. This can be useful for simplifying the display of the legend. We will now give an example of one possible configuration of these settings. We will also turn off the display of vectors to simplify our examination of the contours. And here are the new contours as specified. Note that these contours are for the depth dataset and only fill the extents of the flooded area, whereas before they filled the entire model domain. The shear stress dataset uses dataset-specific contour options, which aid in showing areas of higher bed shear stress near the bridge opening. The water surface elevation dataset uses dataset-specific contour options so as to use a coloring palette that may be more intuitive. From these examples, we can see that proper use of contouring options can dramatically impact the way we view and use solution datasets. Moving to the next topic of lighting, lighting or shading can be useful for observing subtle variations and highlights in elevation data. The many lighting options here can seem overwhelming, but it's not necessary to understand all the detailed options to effectively create some shading or to highlight detail on a model. Perhaps the best way to learn is to experiment with the options and note how the lighting model changes as the sliders are adjusted. We will create two different light settings and compare the one versus the other when shown on a mesh. Note how the different lighting settings can affect the view of contours on the mesh surface in plan view. Next on the list is texture mapping. Texture mapping is basically draping an aerial photo or map image over a mesh or other surface. Pixels in the image are mapped to elevations so the image can be viewed in 3D. Texture mapping is turned on in the general section of the display options, and the drop-down menu there gives the different options. We will select 2D mesh. We will also adjust the Z magnification so that the variations in elevation on the mesh will be emphasized, and we will turn off the display of contours. Texture mapping is performed on the active surface, meaning that if you have more than one mesh and you change the active mesh, SMS will attempt to display the image on the new mesh. The options we've looked at thus far involve the display of data on the surface of a 2D mesh. However, the functional surface feature creates a new surface using a specified scalar dataset as elevation values. The most common use of a functional surface is the display of water surface elevation over a model's bathymetry. The functional surface feature is located in the mesh module of the display options. Here we find options where we can specify the dataset to be used, what Z offset is appropriate, and a Z magnification for the surface, if necessary. The display attributes section controls the color and transparency of the functional surface. It may be a constant color or colored based on contour options. When using contours, the colors may be associated with the values of the functional surface or another dataset. For this example, let's specify the water surface elevation for the functional surface and contour it with the water depth dataset. Note that the water surface elevation dataset is now displayed as a surface and is being contoured using values from the depth dataset. The functional surface and texture mapping features may have difficulties with some computers depending on the graphics drivers and other computer specifications. For a list of the recommended specifications, please see the link to our wiki provided at the end of this video. Before finishing this video, we'll go over one final feature that can be useful when creating reports. The contents of the graphics window can easily be copied to a report in a word processing program by saving an image file or by copying to the clipboard. Before copying to the clipboard, let's make sure the background color is white and increase the scale factor. The scale factor determines the resolution of the image copied to the clipboard. In this example, I estimate the graphics window to be about 1,000 pixels. That's not very much resolution for an image that may be printed. By using a scale factor of 2, the image copied to the clipboard will be 2 times the width and length in pixels of the graphics window. Note the larger image just pasted from the clipboard. The scale factor can be manipulated to provide more detail and sharpness when printing or copying images into a report. This concludes the SRH2D Visualization for Presentation of Results video. Please visit the Federal Highway Administration's website or the SMS wiki pages to learn more.